was and who is and who is still to come. Father, you are holy. You are holy. You are holy, God. You are holy. You are above all. You are through all. You are the one who is seated on the throne. You are the one who everyone bows before. Father, you are holy, 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 holy. You are holy, God. You are holy, God. Everyone will bow before you. Every sickness will bow before you. Every demon will bow before you. Everything will bow before you, God, because you are the name above all names. You are the Lord above our lords. Because you are holy. You are holy, God. You are holy, God. You are holy, God.
Just receive. Strongholds break when I break through. So I'm gonna just go for it this morning. Whatever that looks like for you, just respond to the river of God. Because you never know. You never know when you're one shot away, one lyric away, one phrase away, one song away. I don't know what it is for you, but you're just, you could be just right there on the verge for something, from something just breaking through and breaking open in your life, in your mind. So press. Engage with the press. Engage with the pressing. Press in. Press in. Respond to the river. The river never fails. He'll meet you right there with breakthrough every single time. The river will never fail you. Just continue to press in. Press in with your sound. This room needs your breakthrough. This room needs your sound.
You're holy. want to say yes to the call to come up here with all of our guts. Father, I thank you for the sound of heaven that's beckoning us to come up here and sit with you in a deeper dimension, in a deeper place. So Father, Lord, we just want to go, we want to go after you. Lord, as they were singing that Isaiah 6 narrative, Lord, I thank you, Lord, for that moment when Isaiah came up there, Lord, his first initial thought was, woe is me. But when he began to see from an elevated perspective and began to be touched by what he was seeing, he said, here am I, send me. So, Father, I thank you, Lord, that we belong in throne rooms. That we belong in throne rooms. That we don't have to show up with the woe is me mindset, but we can show up like this is my Father's house and I belong here. This is what he's prepared for me and I belong here. This is the perspective he dreamt for me and I belong here. So Father, Lord, let us just be touched by the fires of heaven, Lord, to consume every other mindset, God, to consume every other mindset, that we have but one mindset, and that mindset is the mindset of Christ that says the earth is filled with your glory, that says, Lord, that we are overcomers, that says we are more than conquerors, that God, that says that you are everything we need and you are enough, Father. You are more than enough, Father. You are more than enough, Father. So we thank you for a touch of heaven. Lord, I thank you for a fresh touch of heaven in this house today. Lord, I thank you, God, for how you move and how you flow. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that even though this might not have been the plan today, Lord, that you begin to germinate a seed that would be released into the atmosphere for others, God, to latch hold of and shift a mindset. Father, I thank you for a people that answer the call. Lord, sometimes we're looking for where you want to send us in the earth, but Lord, let us answer the call to the heavens so that we can clearly see where you're pinpointing us in the earth. Father, I thank you, God, for an elevated perspective, for a renewed mindset, God, for a deeper way of thinking, a higher way of thinking, God, for more of your way of thinking taking over in us. I thank you, God, for it happening. Thank you for it happening. God, if it's good, it's you. So we thank you and we give you glory for your goodness reigning in this house. In your name, from that position of where you sit, we also sit. And we thank you from that position that we say that we are in the position of your name and we decree a truth and it can happen for us. And so we say, so be it over this room for everything that you've dreamed. Everything that you've dreamed today. Everything you appointed today. Everything that you designed for today. We say yes to that, Father. Let us step into it. Amen. Amen. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, worship team. Awesome. Awesome, awesome. Awesome sauce. Right here. Hey, Megan's already on it. You're hearing the ringing too. Rings aren't always good there. Hey, Randall, I want you to go ahead. I want to do that now. I'm going to do that now. This is Randall and his wonderful wife. They are missionaries to Scotland. Is that appropriate to say it that way? Is that what you, whatever titles they go by? They're doing a work of the Lord in Scotland, and they just got back. We've been able to, probably three or four different times we've been able to sow a seed into this ministry and what that they were doing. And they're believing for a building over there. And the process has started they've been there for 30 days. You were there about a month and just got back. And you are within a year, hopefully, of moving over there, right? Is that what we're you'll probably tell him a little bit of that. He's going to take about 5 minutes and just give you the Annandale Annan, Scotland report.
Thank you. One, I roped him into this because, see, I haven't been preaching in probably about 3 years. So you guys are in for a surprise and you don't get any more time. Thank you for the microphone. No, thank you for sowing into this. You may not even be aware that you have planted seeds in Scotland. And you've been doing it for a couple of years now, at least, maybe 3 years. Man, I tell you, the words from worship this morning, they're just all over me right now. And so is my family. Sorry. I'm kind of stunned because there are so many words about the Good Shepherd. I brought this morning. There are words about revival and outpouring. And now the here am I, send me. And it just speaks over our lives tremendously. 6 years ago, we walked around a little town called Annan, and it has 10 to 12,000 people. And this is my ancestral roots. And there's no work of God going on there. Hasn't been for hundreds of years. And that's been verified. Okay. It's known as a place that's spiritually dead. There are people there that do not know who Jesus is, not just as Lord, but do not know the name, which in 2022, that's just phenomenal in my eyes. So we walked around it in the spirit of Genesis 17:6, where the Lord told Abraham, walk around the length and breadth of this land, and everywhere your foot trods, we'll give it to you. Sorry. I've already cried over this once today. We walked around the city, and then every trip we went back for the next 10 trips, we walked all the streets and marked them off on a map until they were all highlighted. That last day that we were walking the last couple of streets, last June, Sherry looked at her phone to see what day it was that we started. It was June 18th, 2016. And this now was June 18th, 2021. 5 years to the day, we finished walking. On those last couple of streets, we came around the corner, and there's a man out hoeing his yard, an elderly man. And I said, good morning. He says, well, good morning to you. And he just started chattering up, and for 15 minutes, we talked over his fence. Come to find out, he makes walking sticks, the traditional ram's horn-topped walking sticks for shepherds. And in the course of events, he gave me one 5 years after we began. We asked God initially, I said, God, this land has no shepherd. There's no one shepherding these people. Give us these people. 5 years later, after the walking was done, he gave us a staff. And we take that as tremendous confirmation that he has called us the shepherds of Annandale. And I get all goofed up every time I think about it. So that was last June. This time we went back. We spent the month of April there. And there is a new season that has started. We know over 100 people in Annan. I think that's more than we know in Springdale, Fayetteville, and Farmington, and, you know, by name that we can just list off. Yeah, specifically by name. We know these people inside and out. And we pray for them throughout the year, even when we're not there. And God has now allowed these connections to go another level deeper, where we know people who know people that we know. And when you go into a foreign community and you can talk that way with people, there's a weaving that takes place with you and them. And it's just been a God thing. But we've had some significant boldness placed on us this time, where some of these relationships that we've had, we've been able to take them further. And where we've been praying over people kind of quietly in the past, we're now doing it in public and able to. And people know that we're there to love them. So the three steps that we take with our mission philosophy, if you will, is we go first as learners. We learn the land, we learn the people, we learn their history. We learn who brought the gospel to the land, when it happened, who brought it, who was worshipped before they came. And then what did they do with the gospel after they received it? What revivals have taken place? Where are the high places? Where are the holy places, the sacred places? And we learn their strongholds. We learn their whole background. So we've done that now for almost 7 years. And God's placed us into a new place. And as we're going through this learning phase, the next phase of this, or the next step that we take, is merchant. So we have arranged to buy a building. We've got the funding now for this building, built in 1730, and it's been vacant for 17 years. So it's right on High Street. It is a prominent building, and it's white, where everything else is red sandstone. So we've had visions and dreams of it, and other people have too. It's going to happen. It's ours. It's ordained. It's going to happen. As far as I'm concerned, it already has. So we've got an attorney working on our behalf to secure that building for us, and we've entered the bidding process, hopefully. So things are rolling. So the next phase now is to become merchants. We're going to have a coffee shop, a coffee roastery. There are no roasters in Southwest Scotland. Another foreign thing coming from Northwest Arkansas, where they're on every corner. And then we're also going to have a children's bookshop. So high-quality children's literature that get into families and teach them the value of reading and the value of the family network in that. That's her department. I'm going to be serving the beans. And the final stage will be teacher. So after we have worked with them and loved on them and served them and allowed them to serve us, we're going to be allowed to speak into their lives more boldly about how our lives are and the peace and the love that we have in our lives and how we're able to love the unlovable they can too and how to be released from their bondage. But I'm going to let Sherry tell just a couple stories about people that she's encountered.
So he mentioned about how we've just been moving painfully slowly over these 6 years to the point where sometimes we don't even know when anything's going to break loose. We felt like we have not been given permission from the Spirit to be bolder in our conversations with people, that it's all been in the background. And so this time, though, there was more permission from Spirit to be bold. And so there were three ladies in particular that I was allowed to do that with. One of them, I'll just be real quick about this, but her name is Hazel, and we've known her since 2016. That trip where we prayed all around the city, I met her, and she's probably my closest friend there that I talk to the most frequently. She is what I've referred to for all this time as like the poster child of Anna, because she is bristly, she is hard as stone, and she wants nothing to do with God because she was wounded when she was young, and she wants, by the Church of Scotland, she wants nothing to do with him. And so, but she loves me, and I have a lot of favor with her. And so last summer when we were, and she's very infirm, she has a lot of infirmities, and she's a little bit older than me. And so last summer when we were there, we were actually, had left Annan to come back here, and we were at the airport hotel getting ready to fly out the next morning. We had to get up at 3 in the morning, and I got a text from her daughter saying that she had just been admitted to the hospital, and that she wasn't very good. And I just knew in my spirit that she was in danger. And so I prayed, and I sent out a request to our prayer warriors, and I just prayed, and I couldn't sleep that night. And I got up the next morning. By the time I got up at 3, I told him and Andrew, our son, that if I got a text before we left our Paris connection to come back here, I was going to turn around and come back to Annan, and they could go on home, because I was not leaving the continent with her about to die again. And so I don't know how I would have afforded that, but I was not leaving. And so we just kept praying. And then I actually never got the text before we left Paris. And it was over the Atlantic when I got a text from her daughter saying, yes, she did almost die. And then somehow, I don't remember the chain of events, but her daughter told me that she really did almost die. But just a few hours later, she was sitting up in bed and eating lunch. And so I sent her a text. I sent Hazel a text, and I said, I want you to know that I was praying for you and God rescued you, and that I was going to come back if I got word from your daughter that you were really bad. I was going to come back and not leave the continent with you being that close to death. And so she didn't respond to that, and I just backed off, because that was about as bold as I've ever been with her. And so this time the subject of that came up in our conversation again, and I told her, I said, I want you to know that I firmly believe that the Lord, he rescued you from death because I was praying for you. And she said, well, I don't want to believe in God. And I said, because you were wounded when you were younger, right? By the church. And she says, yes. And I said, well, I can't pretend to went through with that particular instance, but I can tell you that we have been wounded many, many times by churches. And I just gave her a brief summary of the long and distinguished list of churches that have heinously wounded us. And she was angry at the things I told her they said to us. And I ended it with, I still believe through all of that, I believe that God is good and that he brought us through that, and that those people who said those things to us claim to be followers of Jesus, but they really don't know Jesus and they were not representing God at all. And there's no big bow on this. She didn't respond to it. She just, you know, kind of shook her head and that was it. But there's no way that she can't be chewing on that. And so that was just a huge, huge, like, testimony that I gave her.
Has moving in Annandale, and he told me
that the God of peace wants to dwell there and do amazing things. And I believe it. I believe it. The building's coming. We're going to be able to work among them and watch what God's going to do, because he's not going to show us something he's not going to do. So if we just stay faithful. But we appreciate you and bless you for participating with us in this. Thank you.
Amen. I want to read a couple words for whoever they may be. Start with this one right here. Miss Amanda, sorry, so over here, sent me something this morning. The Lord was speaking to me this morning about mountains being lifted up and cast into the sea. He showed me this as a twofold partnership with him, his spirit and our voice. As his spirit continues to be poured upon the earth and over all men, the atmosphere is primed and ready more than ever for the cursing of fig trees and the removal of mountains. I see old mountains that have been spoken to before but haven't seemed to budge. The Lord says, I'm doing a new thing, and those mountains are ready to crumble. He says, lift your voices and speak to the mountain one more time, or speak to the mountain once more without doubting, and it shall be cast into the sea. Those mountains are not a part of my kingdom, and I have gone before you and loosened the ground. Speak once more, speak again to that old mountain with the authority I've given you. It's ready to crumble. I've dismantled its foundations with a partnership of my spirit and the breath of your words. You will watch it fall. Amen. Bailey sent me a word a little bit earlier. I hear increase our worship. I hear increase our worship. The breakthrough is in the continuous praise. Our worship opens up the floodgates of heaven. Our worship breaks chains. Our worship releases heaven into the earth. Our worship expands our capacity to receive more of him. Our worship changes everything. Be confident in what your praise shifts. Psalm 47, 6 through 9. And then she said, also keep hearing, jump into the deep. Just go for it. The river is calling you to the deep. Psalm 47, 6 through 9 reads this way. Sing and celebrate, sing some more, celebrate some more. Sing your highest song of praise to our King, for God is the triumphant King. The powers of the earth and are all his. So sing your celebration songs of highest praise to the glorious enlightened one. Our God reigns over every nation. He reigns on his holy throne over all. All the nobles and princes and loving servants of the God of Abraham, they all gather to worship. Every warrior's shield is now lowered as surrendered trophies before this King. He has taken his throne high and lofty, exalted over all. I want to, wherever that falls in you, just latch hold of it. And you're like, well, I don't feel like that's for me. Well, that's okay. God will give you one here in a second, all right? So just latch hold of that, whatever you're needing breakthrough in. Increase your praise over that mountain. Can we tie them together like that? Increase your praise over that mountain leaving. I know as Randall and as Randall and Cherry, they were sharing here and talking about Scotland, and they're believing for there's a building in process that God is delivering into their hands that has it through time and has shown that. And apparently you don't get a real estate agent in Scotland, you get a lawyer. And lawyers are what do the deals there, I guess, whatever. Anyways, if you would just stand one more time, I just want you guys just to stretch your hands toward them. And we're just gonna release a word. If you get a word, because we've got a lot of equipped people to do that, if you get a word for them, maybe before they leave or whatever that it is, write it down. Or if you don't get to catch them, and you can text that to me, and I can make sure it gets to them. If he doesn't give you a word, that's okay too. Don't make something up. Here we go. I want you to stretch your hand toward them, and let's just unite together. Agreeing, let's like I say this sometimes on Wednesday night, like Holy Ghost snipers, let's target something right here together in agreement that this building is done. This building is done. So what's the address? Do you know the address on this building? Or what you said it was built in 17? The white building on High Street? High Street, the white building on High Street. All right, y'all got that? You got all the information you need. Let's release breakthrough. Father, we thank you, God, for these phenomenal missionaries to Scotland, Lord, and what you have called and placed and birthed in their heart to do, to shepherd the 45,000 people, God, in the Annandale region, God, and the 12,000 people in Annan, Scotland, Lord. We just call forth to them, Lord, and we say, this is their people, God. This is their people, God. You're sending them a shepherd. You're sending them a man and woman of God to release the words of the Lord to, God, to help them grow spiritually, God. Lord, to not just bring them a word from heaven, but to lead them into green pastures where they hear words for themselves. So, Father, we just release over the White House on High Street, God, and we call it forth, God, into this ministry. And we say this thing belongs to them, God. This belongs to them according to what you have shown them. So, Father, we just speak building breakthrough over them regarding this matter, God. We say, Lord, whatever the appropriate amount of time is, God, and how long a deal like this would normally take, we say acceleration on that thing, God, that the next time they travel over to Scotland, that this will be deeded to them, Father. And we thank you, God, for that type of breakthrough. We call it forth. We speak over them in that ministry, God. And we just pray that you would give favor and prosperity to the businesses that are going to be started in the downstairs area of that building, God, or the main floor, rather, of that White House on High Street, God. And we give you glory for all that you are going to do in that town and those villages, God, through this missionary. We thank you, God, for doing it in your name. Amen. Amen. Hey, Bailey, can you pull me back just a little bit on, not too much though. I feel like I'm rattling something, you know, bones or something. I don't know. Sorry, I was hearing something. Hey, Chad and Bonnie, will you stand up too? I want to pray for you guys. That's what I was messing with Chad up here on the stage. You're not messing with him. I was talking to him. But earlier I walked by Bonnie and I just felt like hit me with a birthing thing again. And so whether that's natural or spiritual or both, whatever that it is, I want you guys just to stretch your hand towards Chad and Bonnie here and just begin to pray for just distinct breakthrough. I believe that there's going to be some just unique birthing things. The unique birthing, like I said, whether it's natural, spiritual, or both, whatever that is, we just say yes to that. So, Father, we just speak over them. We just speak over them. Unique birthings, Father, of what that you are longing and that you have impregnated them with. God, the seeds that they carry have so much capacity within them. Lord, if a mustard seed can grow one of the largest trees in the entire garden, God, the seeds of the Lord, the seeds, the plurality of seeds that is in them, God, to explode forth in this moment, God, as they're birthing and releasing, God, the things that they've been designed to birth and release. God, I thank you, God, for the equipping words of the Lord that is over them, God, in the homes they travel into the clients they meet, God, into other businesses they encounter, God, all around, everywhere that they walk, God, there's the word of the Lord that is coming over them. And some, like what we've heard in the missionary from Scotland, God, they may not even know that this came from the Lord, but Lord, you're speaking a word over them that's impactful to somebody else, regardless if they knew the source where it came from. We know the source that it springs from. And so, God, we just call for a birthing source, God, to speak seeds of life into others, a birthing source, God, to speak seeds of life into their home and into their family, God, and the people that they encounter, God, the people that they encounter. Lord, I thank you, God. I thank you, God, for the things that I see even now. I thank you, Lord, for the things I see even now. I see somebody just riding a bike down the road and God's sending you words to influence them. They're riding a bike. They have very small influence, but God gives you words to influence them. And then I also see somebody flying a plane with large influence and God gives you the words to release influence of heaven into their life. So Father, I thank you, God, for whatever rungs of the ladder that people are dreaming for. Chad and Bonnie aren't dreaming of climbing rungs on a ladder. They're dreaming of the stairways of heaven and what they can access into the heavens and release and decree into the earth. So Father, I thank you for those dreams being birthed into others, God. That down, God, down to the, from like, just distinctly, like from homeless people to people that live in mansions, from homeless people to people that own large corporations and businesses, God, you're giving them favor with both. God, they're giving them influence and favor with both because there's seeds of the Lord in them to reach both avenues, God. Whatever that's unfolding in their life, I thank you, God, that they will birth in multiplicity of arenas. They will birth the words of the Lord in a multiplicity of arenas, and I thank you, God, for doing it. Breakthrough, favor, prosperity over everything they touch. They trust in you that it will be done, that it will be taken care of, that you will guide their words to every bullseye they were supposed to go. Thank you, Father. Amen. 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 Is that all right? We can do that? We can just do that all day, right? Pray for people. Okay, Father, what do you want to do now? Yeah. Yeah. Man. Guys, I think there's going to be some ministry opportunities to just like, I don't know. I talked to Ron the other day. I don't know, maybe this is a conversation for private, but I think that you guys are supposed to go up there on one of their Friday nights and just and share and just speak to the people and encouraging. So there's going to be you're ministering, and everywhere you go, whether it was with a microphone or not, there's this ministry that's going to just like a river of ministry that's just going to be flowing out of you. River of ministry everywhere that you go. You don't have to have a microphone to do ministry. I know I often at times have a microphone doing ministry, but you are walking ministers. You're walking ministers. Why? So that people will see the glory of God through you that's pointing them to Jesus. You should always be pointing people to Jesus by things you're doing. Even if you don't say, hey, do you know Jesus? You might not actually say those words, but there's actions that you're doing and people see the good things on you. You know, I'm just, you know, that's the Bible that you brought in there of this. Let your light so shine before men in such a way that they may see your noble, mobile good deeds and turn and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. So they see the deeds and the things that you do. You don't, faith is not just, you know, it's not a faith of you're not getting to heaven because of the works that you do. But people see the works that you do and it causes belief in them of who that you serve. They see your noble, mobile, good deeds. Your noble, mobile, mobile action taken. The good deeds of that. And they give glory to your Father in heaven. I don't know if they give glory to your Father in heaven because they're saying there's no way this person's that good. Are you with me? Or they're so amazed by the things that flow out of you that they say this is more than just a human. This is somebody from heaven. Okay, so let's read some stuff here in John chapter number 5. I didn't give you that one, but I did a few weeks ago, Bailey. But I'm going in John chapter 5. But before I get there, we need to grab these couple of things here in Mark chapter number 4 that we've been feasting on. And or you might not have been feasting on. I have been. So Mark chapter number 4, Jesus talking about the parable of the sower, and we've went through that. Just some reminders here. The degree of revelation. Vlad actually read the scripture earlier. And did you read Mark 4 when you were praying earlier? You did, didn't you? In Mark 4, this is something that we've been talking about for a couple weeks now. In verse number 24 is what I want to read first. And then I want to grab a couple things. This is just review and some reminders of some things that have been happening in the last 3 weeks here, three weeks to a month. Sometimes, and I know, you know, we didn't have, you know, anything that, you know, to hashtag or anything like that. And so that you could, you know, sermon series or whatever. I don't actually know how long these things go. That when I started talking about eyes of faith, it seemed like it went like 17 weeks. So, you know, there was not like 17 weeks that I started out, you know, it just started out as one thing. And then here we go. So I don't know how much longer we'll be in this, but this is where we're at for right now. And I believe I have another piece to dovetail with this. So in Mark chapter number 4, verse number 24, then he said to them, be diligent to understand the meaning behind everything you hear, for as you do, more understanding will be given to you. And according to the depth of your longing to understand, much more will be added to you. For those who listen with open hearts will receive more revelation. But those who don't listen with open hearts will lose what little they think they have. Now, why is Jesus talking in this language? It seems like the end of that seems like a harsh thing, because the little that somebody thinks they have, they actually won't even have it, because that'll also be stripped from them. Why would it be stripped from them? Because they're people that don't listen with open hearts. They lose what little they think they even have. This is the parable of the talents in Matthew 25. This is the parable of the minas in Luke 19. This is that unfolding. So we're talking about other parables here. So to be diligent to understand the meaning behind everything you hear. The more revelation that you hunger for, the more depth of longing that you will understand, and the more revelation that will be added to you. So you will have revelation added to you based on the degree of hunger that you have for revelation. All right? So now back up to the parable of the sower that starts out in Mark chapter number 4. And this is all heart condition. You know, some seed fell here, some seed fell here, some seed fell here. All right. He gives these places where all the seed fell. One was, you know, let me just give it to you. Consider a farmer, verse number 3, who went out and sowed seeds. As he cast some seeds, fell along the beaten path, and soon the birds came and ate it. Other seed, this is number 2, the other place that seed fell. Other seeds fell on gravel with no topsoil, and seeds quickly sprouted, but the soil had no depth. But then when the days grew hot, the sprouts were scorched and withered because they had insufficient roots. Other seeds, this is the third seed, other seeds fell among the thorns. So when the seeds sprouted, so did the thorns, crowding out the young plant so that they could produce no grain. But some seeds, the fourth seeds, fell onto good, rich soil and kept producing a good harvest. Some yielded 30, some 60, and some even 100 times as much as was planted. If you understand this, then you need to respond. Okay? So he gives this parable, 4 different accounts of seeds of where they are. What you need to know about the seeds here, they were all the same. He didn't give good seeds to one ground and bad seeds to another ground. The seeds were all the same. How do we know that? Because the seeds are actually the word of God. He goes on to explain this in just a moment. All right? So watch this. So moving forward. After Jesus' disciples close to him remained behind to ask Jesus about his parables, he said to them, the privilege of intimately knowing the mystery of God's kingdom realm has been granted to you, but not to others, where everything is revealed in parables. For even when they see what I do, they will not understand. And when they hear what I say, they will learn nothing. Otherwise, they would repent and be forgiven. We pulled this out later. He's talking about outsiders who have no desire to understand. They're not going to understand. Verse number 13, then he said to them, if you don't understand this parable, how will you understand any parable? What parable is he talking about? He's talking about the parable of the sower. So the parable of the sower holds keys to unlocking mysteries in every parable that he says. Isn't that interesting? Like sometimes I think we're running after these other parables, like, oh, what does this mean and what does that mean? If you don't get the parable of the sower, which holds the master key to unlocking all the parables. Can you follow that line of thinking? So here we go. Now let's not be remiss here and forget about this. In Luke chapter 19, I believe it is. I believe it's Luke 19, but when we've preached on this again, this is review of, he says it like this, that the people thought that he was going into Jerusalem to establish an earthly throne. And then it says, so Jesus told them this parable to change their perspective. Everything that comes from the mouth of Yahweh, everything he speaks to you is to change your perspective. Everything he says is to change your perspective. And he's saying that I'm giving you a key here. You need to understand this parable. I've given you the understanding and to know the intimate mysteries of the kingdom. And he said, if you don't understand this parable, how will you understand any parable? So there must be something in the sower that contains a master key to unlocking mysteries in other parables. So let me explain. The farmer sows the word as seed. The word. This is the word of God. What falls on the beaten path represents those who hear the word. In some translation, it actually says the words, the seeds are the words of God. That's if you've got that in your translation, it might actually explicitly say that. But it's saying here the word, but it capitalized word, like the deity of the word. The word, listen, John chapter number 1, it said, and the word became flesh and dwelt among us, okay? So when he speaks Jesus. Can we say it like that? He speaks Jesus. Every time that he speaks Jesus. It's the language of son. It's the language of sonship. He releases the language of who he is into the earth. So what falls on the beaten path represents those who hear the word, but immediately Satan appears and snatches it from their hearts. The seed sown on gravel represents those who hear the word and receive it joyfully, but because their hearts fail to sink a deep root into the word, they don't endure for long. For when trouble or persecution comes on account of the word, they immediately wilt and fall away. And the seed sown among the thorns represents those who hear the word, but they allow the cares of this life and the seduction of wealth and the desires for other things to crowd out and choke the word that it produces nothing. Okay? So it fell on thorns. And I always like to point this out, even though this is review and I've given it to you and I'll give it to you 100 times more this way, that the thorns are another seed. You understand that, right? That thorns, they also sprout from a seed. But they are the opposing seed to the words of God, which are the seeds of life. So there are seeds of death that are spoken into your life, and there's seeds of life that are spoken into your life. And if you're not careful, the seed that you believe will be the seed that determines the reality that you get to experience. But when you partner with God's words and you refuse the seduction of all the other seeds, then that seed is growing, and it's growing in a healthy environment where it's not having to fight against the thorns that have been. Are you with me? So there must be another seed caster in your life, and his name is your adversary. His name is Satan, and he is planting seeds in your mind. You better make sure that to water the right things in your life. How do you water them? You watch over them. The farmer watches over his seeds. You understand that? He's not just out there like willy-nilly here and just like spraying seed all over the place and let's hope there's something that comes of that. No successful farmer is doing that, but they strategically put them in rows and they put them in order, and then they watch over them. They water them. They go pull weeds out. They go do other things like that so that they can make sure that the seed is in a hospitable environment. Okay? And there's nothing robbing the soil. And there's even some farmers that have to kill the deer and the bear and the whatever else that's out there and the raccoons that are trying to take the seed. They have to kill the nuisance things that are trying to steal the seed. There are things the enemy will send your way to take the revelation from you. You need to marry that within your heart. All right, now watch it. Verse 20. But the seed sown on good soil represents those who open their hearts to receive the word, and their lives bear good fruit. But this has completely changed my perspective over the past month. I haven't ever thought about it this way until now. The heart, this fourth seed was seed that all fell on good ground. Like this isn't the heart of somebody that just, this is the believer. Okay? This is the one with open heart who gladly and readily receives the seed of the Lord. And it bears good fruit in their lives. But some of them produce 30, some 60, and some 100 times more than that was sown. Right after this, Jesus goes into this. The one who's hungry for revelation, more revelation will be given until they are satisfied. The one that is a 30-folder in life, they are a 30-folder because they're not hungry enough to be a 60-folder. Can I help you? And the 30-folder in life is not hungry enough to be the 100-folder in life. They all receive the same seed from God. Josh, can you prove that to me? I'm so glad you asked. If you'll flip over there to Hebrews chapter number 4, then we find it this way just as it starts out, that it says that we heard the same report just as they did. Who is they? It is the children of Israel. We heard the same good news report of deliverance just as they did, but they failed to experience it. They heard the same promise from heaven, just as the Israelites did, to enter into a realm of perfect rest with Yahweh, but they failed to experience it. Why? Because it did not. If you go read it in Hebrews chapter number 4, verse number, I'm in verse number 1, going down to verse number like 4, and he says that they didn't receive it. They didn't get into the fullness of that promise. Why? Because they heard the word, but they didn't let it affect them deeply enough, for they doubted. It didn't say they weren't saved. It didn't say they weren't Christian. It didn't say they weren't a believer. It's saying that they heard a promise from heaven, but it did not impact them deeply enough. This is the parable of the sower in demonstration, that there is some that they don't let the roots get there enough. So maybe he's not even talking about unbelievers at all. Can we say it like that? Maybe it's talking about the Sunday morning Joe that got here, but his heart wasn't ready. His hair was, but his heart wasn't. And he didn't work near as hard on his heart as he did on everything else in life. And he got here, and then there was seed of the word that was falling on rocky ground, and it quickly shot up. And he's like, "Oh, look at this!" And then it was burned up because it had no sufficient root system. But then there are those that show up and like, "Oh man, I'm in Bible study. I pray. I intercede," and they have a 30-fold revelation. This is the reason. This is the reason that there is so much division in the churches in America. You can't speak as much internationally, but it's probably there too. But this is one of the reasons for so much division in our churches. Because people with a 30-fold revelation will not most of the time associate with 60-folders. Why? Because the 60-folder will absolutely challenge their theology, and they cannot handle it because the 60-folder has a greater revelation that does not align with the 30-folder statement of faith. You might as well forget hanging out with the 100-folder, because they'll start saying things that you can't even find in the Bible, but you're watching them live it and you're ready to crucify them because they have a revelation of, "Behold, I do a new thing." Let me help you right here. Because there are that people in the earth, and they're 30 and 60 folders, and they're like, "Well, if I can't find it in the Bible, I ain't gonna believe it." And then you'll find a 100-folder that's doing things that are outside the canon of Scripture, but you can't find anything in the canon of Scripture that discredits what they're doing. Never, never fail to receive somebody else's revelation because it's beyond your understanding. But instead, ask God to give you a greater revelation. Now, I always want to say preface there, and it's not preface because it's after I said it. But let me help you in this particular instance, okay? If somebody is doing something that is contradicting to what God has already said, that's not what I'm telling you to receive. I'm talking about the thing, because believe it or not, like, because people want to elevate the Scriptures above everything. The people of the New Testament did not have the New Testament to go by. So you would rather have the Word of God than the Spirit of God that they had. The Spirit of God was in greater measure than the Word of God that they had, because they didn't have the Word of God to go by. So it must mean that the Spirit of God, having a deeper measure of the Spirit of God than an understanding of the words of God. Can I help you? That's too much for me, man. Man, I've heard some weird stuff. Like I've heard people that got information from birds. Like a bird came to the park bench and talked to them, not a parrot. Yeah. Just so long as that's on camera, I'm pretty sure that's going to grow our church. Like for real. Well, I don't have any word. I don't know about all that. Yeah, that's because you got 30-fold, or you may even be a 2-folder. I don't know. But somebody that has a deeper revelation of it, let me not try to discredit that. Sometimes I feel like we would rather try to find the discrediting theology of how to say that this person is wrong than to say, God, increase my understanding to discover that they were right. I would rather believe something that was written 85 years ago by people with a more shallow revelation than the revelation that was written today. Come on. The word is a gate that takes you in deeper. Okay? What about the Bible? It was written 2,000 years ago. The word is a gate that takes you in deeper. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the theologies and the statements of faiths of entire denominations that were written 85 and 205 years ago that we've taken. And believe it or not, somebody probably has a greater revelation at this point, because we are in an era right now where things have changed. Well, what does that mean, Josh? I'm telling you right now, warfare 20 years ago and warfare right now doesn't look the same. The days of shouting at the devil are over. I'm not telling you we're not going to come in here and shout. We ain't doing it at our prayer meetings, but I'm not telling you there's not a church down the road that's going to get together and shout out the devil and see some kind of result, because that I'm telling you that God's gracious and he still releases a result on the fold that you have a revelation of. But there is a superior fold, the increase, the multiplicity of your revelation. He's saying, I'm wanting to grow that thing in you, and you can understand that seated sons are going to do more than sons trying to wield a sword. Seated in proper position will elevate you above every situation, where you can decree things into the situation instead of praying up from the situation, hoping that heaven will hear your cry. But when you get into the heavens and you're allowed to go there, it's called being raptured, by the way, getting up here, translated. So if you've been waiting on one, I'm sorry, that might happen for you. It might happen for you because that's your revelation, that there's one rapture. And that's fine. You will probably go whenever that rapture, whatever that is, whatever that looks like, however that it is, whatever it is, whatever it is, whatever it is. That's your revelation. But there is a deeper revelation than the one rapture, people. And some even like, oh, I'm really out there because I got 3 raptures, but I'm telling you there's thousands of them. And if you can rapture right now, if you want to, it's called being caught up. Did you know that? In Revelation chapter 1, when the revelator was writing it down, and he said, and I was caught up on the Lord's day. That is the Greek word for rapture. I was caught up. Well, I hope there's more than one, because that sucks for you. It's already happened. And it happened 2,000 years ago. We do this all the time. The deeper your revelation of Zion goes, the more accessible heaven will become to you. All right, here we go. Now, I know that's, you know, just some review here of I need this in light of what the Lord is releasing here. And I'm going to attempt to not go, you know, an hour and a half or anything like that today. What did I tell you? John chapter number 5. John 5. Then Jesus returned to Jerusalem to observe one of the Jewish holy days. Inside the city, near the sheep gate, there is a pool called in Aramaic, the house of loving kindness. And this pool is surrounded by 5 covered porches. Hundreds of sick people were lying there on the porches, the paralyzed, the blind, and the crippled, all of them waiting for their healing. For an angel of God would periodically descend into the pool to stir the waters, and the first one who stepped into the pool after the waters swirled would instantly be healed. This does not sound like, well, this sounds a lot more like the lottery and a lot less like the grace of God to heal people, right? Nobody else talks that way or thinks that way about it. Let me read verse number 4 again, just in case you didn't get it. For an angel of God would periodically descend into the pool to stir the waters, and the first one who stepped into the pool after the waters swirled would instantly be healed. That's interesting, isn't it? Boy, I hope I can beat the rest of them there so I can get my healing. Because you better get in the pool, friend, because only one of us is going to get it, and I hope I got the winning ticket today. Come on. Now there was a man who had been disabled for 38 years lying among the multitude of the sick. Somebody was carrying this man for 38 years to the pool of Siloam, hoping that he had the winning lottery ticket this time. Sometimes you're like, man, that is a real bad string of bad luck that this man has been there 38 years. But watch what he says here. When Jesus saw him lying there, he knew that the man had been crippled for a long time. So Jesus said to him, "Do you truly long to be healed?" The sick man answered him, "Sir, there's no way I can get healed, for I have no one who will lower me into the water when the angel comes. And as soon as I try to crawl to the edge of the pool, someone else jumps in ahead of me." Now, I haven't been there to see this, but if you wonder, like, well, why can't you, like he needs, he's a paralytic. He needs somebody to carry him into the water. So somebody there has to have the compassion on him to say that you need healing more than I do, and I'm going to carry you into the water. And for 38 years, he's not found that soul. It's actually a big drop off into the water. You can't just like, why don't he just sit on the water's edge? Because there's steps to get down into it. Verse 8, then Jesus said to him, "Stand up." Now hang on, Jesus, don't you need to lower him down? Don't you need to go down there and, like, you know, dip your finger in the holy water? Stir it up for somebody? Jesus didn't do anything with the water at that moment, but he just said, "Stand up." Why? Because he is the water of the word. He is the pool of Siloam. He's mobile. "Stand up, pick up your sleeping mat, and you will walk." Immediately stood up, and he was healed. So he rolled up his mat and walked again. Now this miracle took place on the Jewish Sabbath when the Jewish leader saw the man walking carrying his sleeping mat. This is the revelation. This is the revelation. This is like the parable of the sower. This is like the parable of the sower. Why? Because there are people there just waiting for their lottery ticket to be called. They had a smaller revelation that I can get healed if this happened, but then Jesus showed up with the fullness of revelation. And he said, "Just stand up, pick up your mat, and you'll walk." To others, he said, "Your sins are forgiven." Oh, this hacked everybody off that was there, that was, you know, of the leaders of the church. And then he said, "Is it easier for me to say your sins are forgiven or get up, take up your bed, and walk? But so that you know that the Son of Man has power to forgive sins in the earth." Come on. "Stand up, pick up your sleeping mat, and walk." Immediately stood up, he was healed. It was on the Sabbath. So when the Jewish leader saw this man carrying his sleeping mat, they objected and said, "What are you doing carrying that? Don't you know it's the Sabbath? It's not lawful for you to carry things on the Sabbath." See, you cannot do work on the Sabbath. Can't do work on the Sabbath in their day. Him rolling up his mat and carrying his bed was considered work. That's why they're at such odds here of why this happened. And then when they start, you'll see later in the story here, they're getting really mad because he was healed on the Sabbath, and getting healed and doing prayer. All this is considered work. And some even went to the degree of, if you cannot pick it up with your pointer finger and your thumb, if you can't carry it with that right there, then it's considered work. And it is now unlawful for you to do on God's holy day. And then Jesus showed up and said, "Well, if your ox is in the ditch, go get it." What? You mean don't let my ox die because it's not Monday? Come on. Then he answered them, the man who healed me told me to pick it up and walk. What man? They asked. Who was this man who ordered you to carry something on a Sabbath? But the healed man couldn't give them an answer, for he didn't yet know who it was, since Jesus had already slipped away into the crowd. A short time later, Jesus found the man at the temple and said to him, look at you now, you're healed. Walk away from your sin so that nothing worse will happen to you. Then the man went to the Jewish leaders and informed them, it was Jesus who healed me. So from that day forward, the Jewish leaders began to persecute Jesus because of the things he did on the Sabbath. Verse 17, Jesus answered his critics by saying, every day my Father is at work and I will be too. What? This infuriated them and made them all more eager to devise a plan to kill him. For not only did he break their Sabbath rules, but he called God my Father, which made him equal to God. So Jesus said, I speak to you timeless truth. The Son is not able to do anything from himself or through my own initiative. I only do the works that I see the Father doing. For the Son does the same thing, or the Son does the same works as his Father. Because the Father loves his Son so much, he always reveals to me everything that he's about to do. And you will all be amazed when he shows me even greater works than what you've seen so far. For just like the Father has power to raise the dead, so will the Son raise the dead and give life to whomever he wants. What's this shift now? The Father now judges no one, for he has given all authority to judge to the Son, so that the honor that belongs to the Father will now be shared with his Son. So if you refuse to honor the Son, you're refusing to honor the Father who sent him. I speak to you in eternal truth. If you embrace my message and believe in the one who sent me, you will never face condemnation. For in me, you have already passed. In me, you have already passed from the realm of death into the realm of eternal life. I speak to you in eternal truth. Soon the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who listen will arise with life. For the Father has given the Son the power to impart life, even as the Father imparts life. The Father has transferred to the Son the authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man. So don't be amazed when I tell you these things, for there is a day coming when all who have ever died will hear my voice calling them back to life. And they will come out of their graves. Those who have done what is good will experience a resurrection to eternal life, and those who have practiced evil will taste the resurrection that brings them to condemnation. Nothing I do is from my own initiative, for as I hear the judgment passed by my Father, I execute judgment, and my judgments will be perfect, because I can do nothing on my own except to fulfill the desires of the Father who has sent me. For if I were to make claims about myself, then you'd have reasons to doubt. But there is another who bears witness on my behalf, and I know that what he testifies of me is true. This is interesting. Let's talk about the belief here. Skip down to verse number 30 here. I'm reading the whole thing for you. You have sent messengers to John, and what he testified about me is true. I have no need to be validated by men, but I'm saying these things so that you'll believe and be rescued. I say these things so that you will believe and be rescued. John was a blazing torch and a shining lamp, was a blazing burning torch, and for a short time you basked in his light with great joy. But I can provide a more substantial proof of who I am that exceeds John's testimony, my miracles. These works, which the Father destined for me to complete, they prove that the Father has sent me. And my Father himself, who gave me this mission, also testified that I am his Son. But you have never heard his voice nor seen his face. Nor does his word truly live inside of you, for you refuse to believe in me or to embrace me as God's messenger. You are busy analyzing the scriptures frantically, pouring over them in hopes of gaining eternal life. Everything you read points to me. Yet you still refuse to come to me so I can give you the life you're looking for, eternal life. Think about that. You're too busy analyzing the scriptures. Wait a second, Jesus. That sounds like a really good thing, and you're putting it in a negative context. You're too busy reading the Bible. Man. You're too busy analyzing the scriptures and frantically poring over them in hopes of gaining eternal life. Everything you read is pointing to me. You still refuse to come to me so that I can give you the life that you're looking for, eternal life. I do not accept the honor that comes from men, for I know what kind of people you really are, and I can see the love of God has found no home in you. I have come to represent my Father, yet you refuse to embrace me in faith. But when someone comes in there on their own name and with their own agenda, you readily accept him. Of course you're unable to believe in me, for you live for the praises of others and not for the praise that comes from the only true God. I won't be the one who accuses you before the Father. The one who will incriminate you is Moses, the very one you claim to obey, the one in whom you trust. If you really believe that what Moses has written, then you would embrace me, for Moses wrote about me. But since you do not believe what he wrote, no wonder you don't believe what I say. This is some stuff. This is some stuff. Go to Galatians chapter number 5. I'm going to pour out over this one, and then we'll tie some things together and head out of here. Galatians 5. Let me be clear. The Anointed One has set us free. Not partially, but completely and wonderfully free. Huh. Let me be clear. The Anointed One has set us free. Not partially, but completely and wonderfully free. So that must mean that some people have partial freedom. Can I help? He set us free. Not partially, but completely and wonderfully free. Well, if complete freedom is available, then why would I settle for partial freedom? That's such a beautiful question. We must always cherish this truth and stubbornly refuse to go back into the bondage of our past. I, Paul, tell you, if you think there's benefit in circumcision and Jewish regulations, then you're acting as though Jesus, the Anointed One, is not enough. I say it again emphatically. If you let yourselves be circumcised, you are obliged to fulfill every single one of the commandments and regulations of the law. But what's Paul saying? Good luck. Verse 4, if you want to be made holy by fulfilling obligations of the law, you have cut off more than your flesh. You have cut yourself off from the Anointed One and have fallen away from the revelation of grace. To whom one longs for revelation, more revelation will be given. Paul speaking to somebody that's trying to go back into an inferior revelation. But Holy Spirit convinces us that we receive by faith the glorious righteousness of the Anointed One. His righteousness is mine. You got that? His righteousness, not part of his righteousness, but everything that is right about God, he imputed upon me. That's good news. When you're placed into the Anointed One and joined to him, circumcision and religious obligations can benefit you nothing. Get this next statement right here. All that matters now is living in the faith that is activated and brought to perfection by love. All that matters now is not keeping rules and making sure that you're in circumcision and that you're doing all the things. All that matters now is not keeping holy days and making sure that you're honoring the Sabbath. All that matters now, come on. All that matters now is living in faith that is activated and brought to perfection by love. Before you were led astray, you were so faithful to Messiah. Why have you now turned from what was right and true? Who has deceived you? The one who enfolded you into his grace is not behind this false teaching that you've embraced, not at all. Don't you know that when you allow even a little lie into your heart, it can permeate your entire belief system? Deep in my heart, I have faith that the Lord Jesus, the anointed one who lives in you, will bring you back around to the truth. So there are people that Jesus is living in that are deceived by a lie. I'm just, you know, convinced that those who agitate you, whoever they think they are, will be brought under God's judgment. Dear friends, why do you think the religious system persecutes me? Is it because I preach the message of being circumcised and keeping all the laws of Judaism? Not at all. Is there no longer any offense over the cross? To tell you the truth, I'm so disgusted with all your agitators, I wish they would go even further and cut themselves off legalistic influence from your life. Beloved ones, God has called us to live a life of freedom in Holy Spirit. But don't view this wonderful freedom as an opportunity to set up base of operation in the natural realm. What? Don't view this wonderful freedom as an opportunity to set up a base of operations in the natural realm. So we need a base of operations that is in a supernatural realm. Freedom means that we become so completely free of self-indulgence that we become servants of another, expressing love in all we do. For love completes the laws of God. All of the law can be summarized in one grand statement. Demonstrate love to your neighbor, even as you care for and love yourself. What's he quoting? Jesus' greatest commandment. What is it? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. What's the greatest commandment? Well, you didn't list any of the 10, Jesus, because I'm breaking you free from the thing that I'm fulfilling so that you'll stop going through the hoops of legalism and rules and regulations to get to the Father. You will now come through me to get through the Father because I fulfilled all of that. And now the greatest commandment from this day forward is to love the Lord your God with all your heart. But if you continue to criticize me and come against each other over minor issues, you're acting like wild beasts trying to destroy one another. As you yield freely and fully to the dynamic life and power of Holy Spirit, you will abandon the cravings of your self life. Watch it now. For your self life craves the things that offend Holy Spirit and hinder him from living free within you. Now hang on. Jesus can live in me, but yet my self-indulgent cravings can put a handcuff on Holy Spirit that would prevent him from living as freely as he would like to live on the inside of me. And Holy Spirit's intense cravings hinder your old self. Hang on, we've got a dichotomy of appetites here. I've got an appetite for this, and Holy Spirit has an appetite for that. And my Holy Spirit appetite is combating that, and it's hindering my old self from raising its head. But then my old self is hindering Holy Spirit from running as freely as he would like to in me. Hit it now, verse 17, hit it again. For your self-life craves the things that offend Holy Spirit and hinder him from living free within you. Stop hindering him from living free within you. Why? Because you end up holding the bag as a 30-folder instead of the greater revelation that he wants to give you. But you didn't let him run free enough in you to inherit the revelation. Why? Because harvest takes time. And though I may be a 30-folder right now, his dream is for me to be a 100-folder. And if I'll continue to long for revelation, I don't have to stop at my 30-fold, but I can move greater beyond that, one degree at a time. And Holy Spirit's intense cravings hinder your old self. That's good news. My old self life from dominating me. So then the two incompatible and conflicting forces are within you are your self-life of the old flesh and the new creation life of the Spirit. But when you're brought into the full freedom of Spirit, of Holy Spirit, of the Spirit of grace, when you're brought into the full freedom of the Spirit of grace, you'll no longer be living under the domination law but soaring above it. You're no longer under the law. You're now above the law. I know that's hard pill to swallow because like, oh, nobody's above the law. That's what we always think about things. Nobody's above the law. Apparently, there are some that are. If you're in the full freedom of the Spirit of grace, you'll no longer be living under the domination of the law, but you'll be soaring above it. Well, Josh, this sounds too crazy for me. It's like a life. You can just do anything, you know, whatever. No. When you're in love with Him, the more wild you let Holy Spirit run in your heart, the less dominating of the old thing can rise up. Because Holy Spirit's appetite is swallowing up the old appetite. But watch what Paul says, verse 19. The cravings of self-life are obvious. They're obvious. Apparently, not to everybody, but they are. The cravings of self-life are obvious. Sexual immorality, lustful thoughts, pornography, chasing after things instead of God, manipulating others, hatred of those who get in your way, senseless arguments, resentment with when others are favored, temper tantrums, angry quarrels, only thinking of yourself, being in love with your own opinions, being envious of the blessings of others, murder, uncontrolled addictions, wild parties, and all the similar behavior. I know there's, you know, this is coming from Aramaic and things. There's drunken binges and different things like that. Haven't I already warned you that those who use their freedom for these things will not inherit the kingdom realm of God? They're in such freedom. There's also, these are obvious, Paul. Why even name them? There are people that are operating in such freedom, but they also feel like that they're licensed to participate in other things. Come on. I've warned you that those who use their freedom for these things will not inherit the kingdom realm of God. But the fruit produced by Holy Spirit within you is divine love in all its varied expressions. Joy that overflows, peace that subdues, patience that endures, kindness in action, a life full of virtue, faith that prevails, gentleness of heart, and strength of spirit. Never set the law above these qualities, for they are meant to be limitless. If you put the law above this thing, it's going to limit you to what you're able to do. But if you soar above the law, you soar into a limitless realm. Keep in mind that we who belong to Jesus, the Anointed One, have already experienced crucifixion. For everything connected to with our self-life was put to death on the cross and crucified with Messiah. We must live in Holy Spirit and follow after Him. So may we never be arrogant or look down on another, for each of us is an original. We must forsake all jealousy that diminishes the value of others. Galatians chapter 5. He's talking a lot about the law there. Go back to John 5, 39. You are so busy analyzing the scriptures, frantically poring over them in hopes of gaining eternal life. Everything you read points to me, yet you still refuse to come to me so I can give you the life you're looking for, eternal life. Verse 45. I won't be the one who accuses you before the Father. The one who will incriminate you is Moses, the very one you claim to obey, the one in whom you trust. Why is he speaking like this? It's found in Luke chapter 19. It's found in Matthew chapter number 25. In Luke chapter 19, he gave some 50. He gave these servants. This is part going back into some review here. He gave him 50,000 gold coins, and he went and made 10 times as much. Had 500,000 gold coin. You know, 50. I'm sorry. He gave him $50,000, and he went and made 10 times as much. So he had $500,000, which would have been, who knows what kind of wealth that would have equated to in that day. Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over the little things, $500,000, which would have been, the Bill Gates of his day, apparently. That, by the way, that was Abraham and, you know, all that, you know, Jesus constantly was lavishing wealth and prosperity on your heroes of faith. And so anyways, he makes $500,000. Well done, good and faithful. You've been faithful with the little. $500,000 is not little right now. It would have been ginormous then. And he said, it's been little. Now I'm going to make you a ruler over much. And he didn't give him any more money, but he gave him 10 cities. True riches is influence over entire regions. Come on. You will be able to park nice things in your driveway when you influence entire regions. But if that's your target, you're aiming at the little when he wants to give you much. And he gave another one. He gave another one this, and he went and made, you know, five times as much, whatever, you know, whatever. Is well done, good and faithful. You've been faithful with a little bit. I'll make you rule over much. But then there was one. And he said, I'm going to bring back what you got. He said, what in the world? He said, I knew you to be a hard man. In Matthew 25, I knew you to be a hard man. In Luke 19, he's saying these same. I knew you to be a hard man. And even accuse him of getting rich off the backs of others. Getting rich off the backs of others. So I'm giving you exactly what you gave to me because I was afraid of you. Why was I afraid of you? Because I knew you were a hard man that would gather where you scattered no seed. You would reap where you have not sown. I knew you to be this way. And because I knew you to be this way, I went and I hid this thing so that I could give back exactly what you gave me. Well, you're wicked and lazy then. You're wicked and lazy. We've said it before like this, and we've been in this. You must think differently about Abba. And then in Luke 19, when you go read it, he doesn't say this in Matthew 25, but he instantly does. And in Matthew 25, he says, if you knew me to be a hard man, then you should have at least put my money in the bank so I would have gathered interest when I returned. But instead, I'm going to take from you what you have, and I'm going to give it to the guy with 10 talents in Matthew 25. I'm going to give it to the one with 10 talents because the one that has more, more will be given. What more? To the one who has more, more will be given. Why? Because the one who has more is longing for revelation, and more revelation will be poured out to him. But the one who has little, even in Mark chapter number 4, even the one that thinks that he has something, I'm going to take the thing that he thinks that he has because he could not hear me with an open heart. He was an outsider that did not want to understand who I really was. And I'll take from him what he has. It's not Jesus being mean to somebody. You refuse to change the way you think about who I am. So I'll take the very thing that you thought that you have, and I'll give it to the one who has even way, 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 way more than you, because the one who has more, more will be given. That's interesting, isn't it? In Luke number 19, because in Matthew 25, he said, Jesus begins to immediately judge the man in the parable based on his own words. You knew me to be a hard man. So he judges him based on the words of, you knew me to be a hard man. Isn't it amazing that all three of these guys got judgment, but two of them was, you've been faithful, enter into the joy of the Lord, I'm going to make you ruler over much. And one of them gets judged and gets thrown into the lowest parts of hell. Isn't that amazing? All three received judgments, but two of them received judgments of love, and one of them received judgment casting them into hell. Because they all received something according to their ability, and then they did not. Two of them went out and they had a view of the master that said, I'm empowered and I'm authorized to multiply. If you go read it in Matthew 25, it says immediately he went out to multiply. As soon as he left, immediately he goes out to multiply. The other one, just like the first one, immediately goes out to multiply. But the third one said, I'm gonna hang on to that. Why? Because I serve a mean person. His view of God is what he was judged on. That's why A.W. Tozer said the most important thing you'll ever do is to think rightly about God in his book, The Knowledge of the Holy. The most important thing you'll ever do is to think rightly about God. Your view of God is how you will be judged. And Luke 19, you don't have to take my word for it. We've been talking about it. You can go read it for yourself. But he says to the man, he says, I'm going to judge you by your own words. What does that have to do with all this stuff that you're talking about here and what you're reading? In Galatians, in John chapter number 5, in Galatians chapter number 5, Paul is talking about the law here. He's talking about the law and all this stuff. And then in John chapter number 5, he said, you're frantically poring over the scriptures trying to get eternal life instead of receiving it from me when I'm here to give it to you. And then he says, I'm not going to be the one that condemns you before the Father. Your judge will be Moses. Why? Because it's their own words. It's their own words. You want to live by the law? You will be judged by the law. But you refuse to change the way you think that Moses was writing about me and not a set of rules to get to God. So you're going to get judged by Moses. Come on. Why? Because it was Moses' words that they lived by that has skewed their view of the Father. All of John 5, he's talking and he's saying, you've seen, I don't do anything except what I said. They're freaking out because he did something on the Sabbath. They're freaking out because he says, my Father, implying that he was equal to God. But I need to take it a step further for you, and we can prove this out even throughout the scripture here. But he's saying that, and Paul in Galatians 5, that we've been co-crucified. We've been co-crucified with Jesus. We've been co-crucified. A lot of people understand the co-crucified concept, but they stop their co with crucified with Jesus. But I need to help 7 people right now that you've been co-crucified with Jesus. You've been co-buried with Christ. You've been co-resurrected with Christ, and you have co-ascended with Christ. And the degree of revelation that you'll let your co go, it'll lead you eventually into 100-fold revelation that I am co-seated with Christ, and I operate in him because I'm fully in him and he is fully in me. And if I'm fully in him and his words framed worlds, then that word that is in me when I speak, my words will frame worlds. And that's why that there is a power in my tongue that can produce life and death, because what I speak will frame the world of my current reality. But when I partner with the right one and the right seed, and I say that this is the thing that I'm in and this is the thing that is in me, and I begin to speak the words of life over everything I'm in, I am framing a world of life in my current reality, and I see a different result than what I used to see because I partnered with a different thing, because I got hungry enough to get a deeper revelation of more than just co-crucifixion, of it is finished. That was a beautiful place to stop. It was a nasty place to stop, and I stepped into co-burial, and then I stepped into co-resurrection, and if the power of Christ's resurrection, his resurrection is my resurrection too. That must mean that his ascension is my ascension too, and I can get seated in heavenly places, co-seated with the Christ that is fully in God and God is fully in him. But Christ in me is that hope of glory. So I let that revelation go a little bit further. So that means the fullness of God is on the inside of me, and the fullness of me, are you with me right now? The fullness, I'm fully in him and he is fully in me, and the degree that I let Holy Spirit run wild in my heart, and that according to Galatians 5 can determine, and it's hinging the very reality that I get to experience. This will determine if you're going to be 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. Maybe somebody's not even in the 30-fold. You're the one that keeps getting it on the rocks and the seed on the rocks, and it sprouts up and it's not producing anything. Not producing anything. This is Jesus goes on, he makes statements like this. The harvest is ripe, but the laborers are few. What's he saying? We don't have enough laborers? No, nonsense. Don't think that way ever again. That's not what that word means, that there's not very many laborers. The laborers are few comes from the Greek word, which means neutered, neutralized. What? He's saying that the laborers are few, saying that they lack in power. We don't have, it's not that there's not a big enough number of laborers, it's that they have been neutered to where they cannot reproduce. They have been neutralized. Comes from the Greek word, which means to neutralize, which comes from where you get a word called neutered, which means, you know, if you got a dog that's neutered, he's not having any puppies. They cannot reproduce in the earth because they're anemic. They're weak. There's plenty of laborers, but they are few. They lack in power. They're two-folders, they're 30-folders, whatever that they are. They're ones that just have the word of the Lord fallen on rocks in their life, and it springs up, and it looks like they're a believer. We're not talking about heaven or hell. We need to be talking about that even less and getting people more into sonship. Getting them into sonship instead of trying to get somebody to repeat a prayer after us. Stop getting them to repeat prayers and teach them how to pray their heart. Let them pray their heart, and that'll open up the belief in them. Teach them to go deeper. Listen, friend, if you live and die a sheep, it doesn't mean you didn't get to go to heaven. It just means you fell way short of where he dreamed for you to be. His dream for me is not to live as a sheep. It's to live as a son. I can stay sheep as long as I want to stay sheep, because there are 30 folders. But sons have the opportunity to have a greater revelation multiplied in them. Where are you letting the word of the Lord fall? This will change everything. This will change how you do business. This will change how you do marriage. This will change how you raise children. This will change how you do everything. When you stop cutting yourself off of somebody else's revelation because it's beyond what you can currently understand, and you long for more revelation, and God continues to pour out more revelation because there's somebody, you're not the one that has 10 talents every time. I have to understand that I believe that I probably could have a 100-fold revelation in a certain area, but I might be a 2-fold revelation in another area, so I need somebody along to come down my road that releases a greater revelation over the 2-fold area of my life so that I don't shun that moment, but I can grow in that moment. The kingdom is growing. Mark chapter 4, it's the parable of the sower. It's the parable of the lamp. It's talking about the condition of the heart. And then he talks about the mustard seed. He talks about the seeds growing, the harvest. Listen, the kingdom of God is not diminishing in the earth. It's exploding in the earth. This is why I bring this up. You can stand with me. I'm quitting here. Oh, well, it's time to quit anyway. So yeah, stand with me. This is why I bring this up in 2020, that for it, this changed my perspective forever. In 2020, riots happening in the streets just because out of lack of revelation. Riots happening in the streets. There was, global pandemic, and I don't know if I haven't read enough articles in the news yet to know if we're still in a pandemic or not, but whatever. But and apparently there's a new virus out. Anyways, so all this is happening, and I said, God, what are you going to do about all this chaos? And he immediately took me into the Isaiah 6 narrative, and he said, the earth is filled with my glory. The earth is filled with my glory. I needed a deeper revelation of the reality I was looking at. Because there's a lot of people that aren't in a great enough fold that can only see the earth being blanketed in darkness. But when your revelation goes beyond the veil of darkness that you see blanketing the earth, you'll step into the Isaiah moment of rise and shine, my light has dawned. You'll step into the moment that the earth is filled with the glory of God. The earth is filled with the glory of God is such an interesting statement from the six-winged creatures with eyes all around their head that are circling the throne of God. It's because I always thought they only have eyes for him, but that's not actually so, but it is so. And it's interesting because how could they only have eyes for him and only be looking at him, but then decreeing something about the earth, saying that the earth is full of his glory? But maybe they were looking into a future brighter day because they were looking from an eternal realm that doesn't have time linearly, it's circular, and from a circular position of time they could see a day where Christ in me, the hope of glory, that seed was sprouting in the earth until the knowledge of the glory of the Lord was covering the earth as the waters cover the sea. And they were looking at the throne of God, and they were looking at the earth at the exact same time, and they said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the earth is filled with his glory. They were looking at a day where the earth was covered in the glory of what they were looking at on a throne. Maybe they were looking at a day when I got co-seated with Christ, and they said, that dude's in the earth and he's here in this glory. The earth is filled with his glory. Because manifest sons, the whole earth is groaning, travailing, standing on tiptoe edge, waiting for the manifestation of sons and daughters of God. The earth is filled with His glory. That must mean the manifest sons said, "You don't have to cry anymore. I'm here now." You know, or we can continue with our onefold revelation of everything good's for the afterlife. Everything good's for now and later. Which is an awful candy. I'm glad they stopped making that, by the way. Did you guys ever have those? Like, you chew on it now, you taste it later. It's like, it won't stop. It gets stuck everywhere. Whatever, that's what happens in my mind. Welcome to my world. I'm going to pray over you. I want you to let this just stir in you. Look, I don't understand everything. I don't understand everything. If you want to know some like really weird stuff, I can tell you some really weird stuff that's happening like right now in the earth where people know people and do things that are not humanly possible. And they're in God. I can't give you, you know, burning dove feathers or two angelic visitations or seven scriptures to back it up. I can just tell you, hey, this happened. I don't know. I'm not there yet. I currently know a couple people on the planet. I don't even really know them. I'm aware of a handful of people that operate differently than the rest of us. What happened? Their revelation increased, and they begin to access more of the cosmos. I can tell you something. Like, I can tell you some weird things, man. Like, just when he said, "Let there be light," it didn't stop. It's still producing at like a violent force. It's still going. I've seen it in the spirit. Like, it's just like a constantly going ball. It doesn't have momentum. It has force. It never stops because his words are forceful. Momentum implies that force has left it and it'll eventually slow because momentum can't go forever, but force never has to stop. Force means that the hand has left it. Or I'm sorry, momentum means the hand has left it, but force means it'll just go forever. I've things that God has shown me and things that I've gleaned from others that he showed them. I can't cut myself off from it because I didn't understand it. Let's grow into it and say, "God, what are you showing me out of this?" "Well, I can't get all of that." Well, then maybe you can get one thing out of the 10 things I just told you. What's he wanting to grow in you? Father, I thank you, God, that you are growing us into greater sons. God, you're so proud of where we are right now. You're such a good father. You're such a good father. God, I tell my son I'm proud of him. God, I'm proud of him when he doesn't hit the ball. I'm proud of him when he hits the ball. God, he Kaysen's yet to hit a home run over the fence. But I'm proud of him anyway. But if he sticks with it and he matures, he'll hit the ball over the fence. So, Father, I'll be proud of him then, but I'm proud of him now, just like you, God, are proud of us now, even though we don't seem to be hitting home runs. We're hoping for singles. But yet, God, you're proud of us. So, Father, you're so proud of us where we are in this growth journey of what you're dreaming for us to be, but you're growing us up into the maturity of greater sons, where one day we step up to the plate to hit home runs. Because you let the revelation increase, keeping us hungry and keeping us thirsty for the righteousness of God. That brings satisfaction according to Matthew 5, God. According to Mark 4, God, them that hunger for more revelation will be given to them until they are satisfied. So God, we thank you, God, for being able to stay hungry and being able to stay thirsty and saying to Holy Spirit that there are no dark corners of my heart that is off limits to you, but you have possession of the entirety of my heart. That if
if you just reveal to me if I need to sweep out any corner, God, any of the four corners or chambers of my heart, God, that you have absolute reign in my heart. Grow us into that, Father. Lord, right now, maybe it's a prayer and later it's a manifestation. So, Father, we just thank you, God, for what is the prayer of now that becomes the dream manifestation of later, God, that we don't cut ourselves off from anything, God, that we are not letting the religious systems of the world cut us off from anything. But I prophesy a new day arising in the earth of systemic exodus, where people are done with the religious systems of the world that never have been able to satisfy the longing cries of men. The whole earth is still crying, and Baptist denomination couldn't do it, and Assemblies of God denomination couldn't do it, and this denomination couldn't do it, and the Catholicism couldn't do it, God. And satanic things couldn't do it, God. Lord, that we call them out of every religious system. Every religious system. And we say, Father, what they were looking for in answers, God, even some that went into witchcraft and different things, trying to find an answer. God, we are the answer. We are the answer. Let us manifest the answer. Let us manifest the answer so they stop trying to live on thorns when we've got the bread of life. Let us realize more who we are as beloved sons than at any other moment in our history. At any other moment in our personal history, let us realize now more than ever how beloved our identity is as sons and daughters. Let us manifest all of you. I didn't get partial freedom. I got access to entire freedom. It's my own fault if I don't have a revelation deep enough to take me into all freedom. I wasn't hungry enough to get there. So let there be an increase of hunger in us for more revelation that you're wanting to pour out over us, that we get to the place of complete and absolute freedom in all areas. We speak breakthrough over every person in this room. Breakthrough through hunger. Breakthrough through thirst. Breakthrough through hunger and thirst for the mysteries of God and what you want to reveal to us and what you want to show to us. God, maybe there are answers in the earth that are still undiscovered by men, but the one that goes deeper in revelation can do it. God, there are scientists that took secrets to the grave because the technology wasn't available in their day, but they could see a greater day. And God, maybe this is the greater day. Maybe there's technology in a greater day of now where witty invention can start popping up in the earth like never before, because sons and daughters got a deeper revelation of what you are whispering to them. Increase that, Father. God, I thank you for doing these things. I thank you for the breakthrough, God, and we prayed over Scotland and over birthing and different things, God, and in the room. And I thank you, God, for doing those things. I thank you, God, for doing those things. I pray over this people and I say, God, bless them with favor and honor everywhere they go and everything they touch. God, favor and honor. God, we say these signs follow them that believe. God, that some will believe because of the miracles. God, the miracles. God, let them be workers of miracles. God, they're endued with power from on high. And if they're endued with power from on high, it wasn't just to make them bilingual. It was that they could work miracles and others could believe in Christ because of the miracles that are flowing through them. So we prophesy miracles over them. We say these signs follow them that believe, and we thank you for the believers' miracles that are happening in the room even now, and when they walk in the job site and wherever they go, that miracles begin to just follow them everywhere they go. Atmosphere changers, multi-dimensional believers. Thank you, Father. Let us go beyond the three dimensions they may know. Take us beyond even the 48 dimensions of you. God, release over them. Release over them. identify dimensions. Take them deeper than they've ever been. Favor on them. Blessing on them. Protection. We trust that that's done. You sent angels ahead of us to make that journey a success. And we thank you, God, that it is finished. Amen. Did anybody come today needing healing in their body? Wait a moment. Just wave at me. I'm going to pray over you. Anybody? Praise God. We can leave now with a report that they were all healed. We got it? You're covered. We've been praying over people, and, you know, and now we don't have anybody to pray over for today. We've been praying over people for a month. I guess y'all need to go find some sick people this week so we can pray over them next week. Why not? Or maybe you could bring them to church because you healed them in the street. Well, whatever tickles your fancy, we just need to get it done. Amen. Guys, we love you. Thanks so much for being here. Blessings on you. If you had a word for Mr. Randall and Sherry and you want to give that to them, or you can text it to me and I can get it to them. If you didn't have a word, that's also okay. But we say blessings on you. Amen.